Friends, welcome to the 9th Advanced Technical Talk of 2016. Advanced Technical Talks, as most of you already know, is about knowledge sharing. We meet about once a month, and one of us gives a talk on some topic related to science or technology that interests them. But every quarter, we have a special talk in which we invite a scientist or a technologist from outside Cadence to talk about their field of interest. The aim of these talks is that we would know about what's happening in, you know, the research areas which probably we'd not encounter on an everyday basis. Today happens to be one of those special talks. Today we have Dr. Ganesh Bagler with us. Dr. Ganesh Bagler did his PhD from the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology. After completing his PhD, he joined the National Center for Biological Sciences in Bangalore. He then went to the Max Planck Institute for Molecular Genetics in Berlin, Germany. After returning back to India, he joined IIT Jodhpur. He is currently at the Center for Computational Biology at IIIT Delhi. He has a wide range of interests. He's interested in physics, computer science, biology, and he's able to use these vast interests to find areas where these fields of studies overlap. He has done research in protein structures. He has used graph theory to understand diseases and how they spread. And he did a very interesting research last year trying to understand the molecular foundations of Indian food. And that's one of the topics that he will talk about. So let's welcome Dr. Bagler.
Thank you. Good morning and welcome to all of you. First of all, it's a privilege to be here at Cadence. Knowing Cadence and the nature of advanced technical talks is definitely an honor to be called for such a talk and given an opportunity to share the knowledge, which I understand is the essence of the advanced technical talk. So in the coming 1 hour, 15 or 20 minutes, what I would like to do is to take you through a broad landscape of computational biology, which is little detached and away from most of people that you're working here, I understand. You'll be dealing with software, partly physics, maybe electronics, right? Whereas this area seems to be slightly away, but what I will try to do is to connect with the computational part, which I presume you'd be able to connect very well, about how computation, despite it sounds not so possible, can actually touch upon the biology to look at certain problems that are existing in biology and probably look for good opportunities that are available by which you can answer some of the questions in biology. Right. First of all, once again, I'll thank Kanwarpreet for inviting me here, as well as Sneha Saurav, who was one of your colleagues here at IIIT Delhi. He's trying to bridge IIIT Delhi and Cadence through the work that he's doing. So thank you to both of you. So I come from Center for Computational Biology, IIIT Delhi, which is trying to excel in the areas of computer science, electronics and communication engineering, as well as in computational biology and expanding its wing into other areas of IT and allied areas, right? So it's one of the beautiful places, and it's one of the growing organization with a culture, modern culture, and giving freedom to researchers as well as nourishing the values of teaching. Right. What I'll be talking today, definitely, as I said, will be about living entities as opposed to software, electronics, and other non-living entities. Right. I have a training in physics. In fact, my primary training is in physics, followed by computer science. So for me also, it was a major move to enter into the messy world of biology, trying to understand it and also trying to find out interesting questions which I can answer with the kind of training that I have. But I would like to impress upon you today that biology is no more what we used to think biology is, right? It has changed over a period of time, and that's what I'm trying to take you through. So when we look at living things such as these, plants, animals, etc., we have certain questions that we ask in our mind about how did these things exist? How did they come into being in the first place? How do they work? Right? And people who ask these questions have been trying to answer this by trying to see how are they categorized, like what are the different types of plants there. You know, are they kind of one which are having, what kind of shapes of the leaves they have, what kind of branching pattern do they have, what kind of fruits do they produce, etc. So biology historically has been more about classification, categorization, etc., which is what I guess many of us had detested when perhaps we disenrolled from biology at some point of time in our life, right? So that's how we think biology is. What I'm trying to do today is that such biological systems that I'll be touching upon today, such as that of a protein structure, which exists at a level of a nanometer, very small one, right? And a cell, which is approximately a few micrometers of the dimensions. And, you know, anatomical organs, such as that of a heart or a brain, which are of the order of a few centimeters. These are the biological entities that I'll be referring to, and invoking the metaphor of a radio, which I presume most of us would love to think about it in that way. Because always, I mean, when we try to comprehend things which are unrelated to us, we like to have an analogy, a metaphor. So I'll be invoking the metaphor of a radio here. Okay? The major difference we must realize is that as opposed to this entity, the radio, you know, electronics artifact, being an engineered thing, something of which the basics, fundamentals of which are very well understood by way of physics, the solid state physics, or for that matter, electromagnetism, and therefore designed to serve a certain purpose, you know, to receive signal, to tune and to magnify signal and convert it into audio signal back again. As opposed to that, these are not engineered entities. These are tinkered entities. And the tinkerer is an invisible entity called evolution, natural selection, right? Therefore, the mechanisms by which these entities have come into place is very, very different from that of a radio. But despite that, we'll try to see this and what kind of contradictions we end up landing up if you take this metaphor, right? So I'm going to talk about, a story about a biologist. I'll touch base with that story again. Very interesting story and a funny story at the same time, about a biologist finding a wonderful radio, or maybe a bunch of radios, which are all functional all of a sudden. And he or she is surprised to see this wonderful entity working very well, creating nice sound, you know, saying, you know, this is, you know, yeah, maybe when we tune to something, all of a sudden we start hearing that, yeah, Akashwani hai, right? And that's wonderful to hear it for the first time without knowing how it works, right? So a biologist ends up finding a beautiful artifact called radio. What happens after that? We'll come to that again. So what I want to do is to take you through broadly three phases. One, a very, very quick introduction to how computation has been used, has been applied in the area of biology to answer a certain questions, and what are those burning questions that are still there and we need to be answered. I'll touch upon those quickly. And while doing that, I will also introduce you to some of the entities which are used in modern biologies, right? Further, I'll take you through the story of asking this question about, can a biologist fix a radio? And when I say biologist, I mean you and me, who are asking this question, that how does this plant grow from a small seed and create all the, you know, in its vibrant form, how does it come into existence? How does it end up creating flowers and the fruits that it does create, right? Why am I getting fat? Can I actually do something so that I can actually, lose my weight, right? And all such, and why do I get unwell? What kind of drug should I take so that I can get better? Or even for that matter, the questions which are hitting the rock bottom of consciousness, that why am I here? Who am I, right? You can ask this question. So I'll be touching upon those disease aspect and the brain aspect of it, and how the modern biology is changing the paradigm of what kind of questions can be asked and what kind of methods are available for that. I'll touch upon those things here. And finally, I'll take you through a very quick survey of the work that we are doing in our laboratory, the complex systems laboratory, as I call it. Incidentally, it is now spanning over different places. Like I worked in as a scientist in CSIR in Palampur, Himachal Pradesh, Institute of Himalayan Bioresource Technology. So some of my students are working there. Then in IIT Jodhpur, some of my students are working there. And now I'm in Delhi. So we are essentially working in a virtual lab, working on questions which touch upon the aspects of what are biological complex systems. So I'll touch upon that also, right? I request you, if there are some pertinent questions, burning questions without which you can't get the flow of the talk, do point the questions. But otherwise, given the nature of the talk, my request would be to hold your questions till the end. where we could come back to all your questions and, you know, go through them. And I'll try to answer as many as possible. And, you know, be patient with me. I may not be able to answer many of them, but I can still possibly direct you about where you should go and what you should read so that possibly you can get an answer for that. Right? So let me start the first part. That if you consider a living cell also as a radio, then the question comes, what are the components that are there, right? So a lot of time has been spent, maybe over a period of centuries now, to understand how living things are made, okay? So it took a lot of time for us to realize that they're actually made up of entities called cells, including our cells, by the way, right? And when you look at an individual cell, such as that of a plant cell or an animal cell, we know that there are it has got a cell membrane, something which bundles everything inside the organelles, and you have lots of weird things floating around it, right? You have the so-called nucleus, and within the nucleus you have a bunch of long chain of molecules called DNA, which apparently is the seed of everything. You know, that's the thing which actually codes, quote-unquote, for the life which this living thing is supposed to embody. And there are many other things which are floating around, meant to be there for certain reasons. But let us remember again that unlike an engineered system, these things are there plainly because of accident, tinkering, but they are functional, right? Right now, we are sitting here thinking, right? That's all a functional entity, right? So there is a reason for all this to happen. So what has happened is that in last 6 to 7 decades, this picture of the so-called the central dogma of the modern molecular biology has come up, where we realize that the living entities, apart from seeing through the conventional way, that is how they are at a level which is easily visible, make better sense the moment you look at them through the molecular entities which they hold within, and also from the fact point of view that they are the ones which are actually coding some information. So there is some information processing happening at the molecular level. And the dogma says that we have all got the DNA inside us, a long, long, long chain of molecule, which is converted into, in the language of biology, it is transcribed into its corresponding another molecule called mRNA, okay, which seems to be a messenger kind of a molecule, which further is converted into its corresponding amino acid. So there are rules available about what kind of a molecule will be made here and what kind of encoding will be here, from starting from DNA to mRNA and further to into its corresponding the so-called protein backbone, right? And more importantly, this protein chain gets folded into its final three-dimensional shape. It has got some functional shape. Without having this three-dimensional shape, the protein would not be able to do its job. And it looks like most of the living thing is essentially, they are able to do their job primarily because of large number of molecules, including proteins, which are participating in various biological processes, right? So this is the so-called central dogma, right? So what's happening over a period of time is that these sequences, which were earlier, let's say in the 80s, were not available in such a large number, have been increasing. In fact, until 2000, we had only a very small number of sequences available to us, those of essentially of microorganisms, and then the big success, that of human genome, that was sequenced over a period of a few years, in fact a decade, where we got the whole human genome sequence, and there was a lot of hype around it, plainly because we thought that this is the book of life. The moment you understand and get the sequencing done of the whole human genome, we'll be able to understand how the proteins are formed, and thereby we should be able to control various processes of life. Essentially, we are talking about diseases. We should be able to control the diseases, right? Turned out that the story is not as simple as that. Not only that, there are a lot of challenges that are coming up the moment you end up getting lots of data about the sequences and the structures of these molecules, right? And the challenge here is embodied in terms of the cost of sequencing a particular genome has gone down very fast in the last decade or so, and it has come to a level where if you are having a small amount of money, I mean fairly middle class person, you'll be able to sequence your genome if you're interested in it. It's not so expensive anymore, right? And it can be done at a very fast scale, like in a matter of week, you should be able to get your sequence in your hand. What do you do with that is a question, different question, but at the same time now, labs across the world are sequencing genomes of various organisms, right, from plants to bacteria to animals, etc., to understand and model them, model the processes which are embodying these living entities, and hopefully with the hope of controlling it. Right. So this is to talk about first, the biological sequences is one form of data that is that has become increasingly available to us. Okay, the human genome, which is it has got around 3 billion base pairs. Every base pair is nothing but one nucleotide. The adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine, ATCG, and you have such 3 billion of them, quite a lot of them, right? Once you get this data, then of course, what to do with that is the second next question. One of the thing is how to get this whole sequence in the first place. The reason it was so arduous, it was because how do you first read this sequence, starting from a living cell, for example. If you take blood, or for that matter saliva, how do you extract the DNA out of it, and further, how do you read it? So there are techniques which are coming, experimental techniques, which have evolved over a period of time, which is what I'm saying, has accelerated quite a lot, and we understand a lot about how to get the sequence. But still, the question still remains that if you can come up with a better algorithm, a computational techniques, by which you can actually assemble the whole genome. The problem being that, the genome being such a large entity, such a huge molecule, it is not possible for us to have an experimental technique by which you could sequence the whole genome in a single go. So what we are able to do is that we are able to get the fragments, small fragments at a stretch. And the job then comes that these are random segments. We are not able to store them very well, but we need to somehow align them one over the other and try to get the full assembly, right? That's what we are talking about here, the assembly. So that's one of the major questions that is lying in front of us. Although there are existing techniques available to us today, this is an open question given the volume of the data that we are getting. How fast and how efficiently we can do it so that the errors are reduced. Because any error creeping into this process, thanks to our method, will lead to wrong interpretations. Yeah? Okay, so the question is about what is a genome? So in the picture that I showed you earlier, the bundle which is sitting here within the nucleus, it's a long chain of molecule which is sitting in the nucleus. That is the whole total of it could be called as a genome, bunch of all DNA sitting together there, which essentially holds what we popularly know as genes. They are the ones which are encoding things. And when we talk about genes, this is the mechanism that we are talking about. Typically, it is the gene which is getting transcribed and translated as a functional entity. So a genome is a sum total of the DNA content in a cell.
So are we trying to decode it?
First, we are trying to read it. Decoding is the next part. The decoding is in terms of understanding why is that particular sequence there? How does it help me, a cell for that matter, to survive? Right? Yeah. So assembly itself is a big question, having got fragments because of the experimental limitations that we have with us. The second is the alignment problem. And the reason why we need to align sequences is because evolution, through evolution we have speciated, starting from very simple organisms, we have grown into more and more complex organisms, right? So some of the molecules which were earlier there, the genes which were there, have got modified and variations have entered into them. But still, if you get a new gene today, I'll be able to compare it with the existing gene which has been already very well understood through experimental studies, and probably be able to say that the function of this particular gene that I'm getting here is of this sort. For example, it is contributing to a hemoglobin molecule. I'll be able to say that. So aligning and comparing two sequences allows me a lot of biological interpretation to be done. And that is where, what is the best way by which I can align two sequences is one of the questions that is, burning question, which has been answered already, but given again the volume of the data that we have, can we do it as biologically meaningfully as possible and faster is another question that we still need to address in the presence of a large number of nucleotide sequences that we are having. So this question is more about, this was more about how do I accurately get the existing information there? Because we know that the DNA is there and it is having certain sequence. How do I get it correctly thanks to the experimental technique followed by algorithmic methods for aligning, for assembling? And the second one is more about interpretation. Like what kind of information it is holding? What kind of molecule is this? What kind of protein it is coding for? What function it might be eventually ending up doing in the biological cell? Well, that interpretation part is something which goes into the alignment problem. Okay? Now touching about the protein structures. As I said in the previous slide when I showed you the central dogma, the question was, after the protein, the proteins which are polymer chains made up of amino acids. These are small molecules, okay, which are 20 types of different amino acids, which are stitched together through covalent bonds, and they create what is called as a linear polypeptide chain. And in a real life situation such as now, proteins are folding at a very fast rate. In a little microseconds and even a fraction of seconds, actually they are folding. And without, if they were not folding correctly in within our living cells, we wouldn't be functioning properly. So, something going wrong in the folding, protein folding process might lead to biological malfunctioning. Okay? That's one of the reasons why looking at the protein sequences and the process by which they end up creating the three-dimensional structure is a very interesting problem for us. And the interesting thing here is that we know that the information that is required by which through some physical mechanisms and even the chemistry involved in it, the linear chain, which is random, gets folded into a very nice structure, which is what is leading to biological function. The information is already available in the chain. We know that. And experiments which were done by biophysicists have shown that, in fact, if you make it unfold by putting some unfolding chemical into it, around it, after that, if you leave it to itself, it's able to fold back into its so-called native structure. These are called native structures, which are functional, right? How does it end up doing it is a big question. In fact, today, the question has been hanging around for so long that it is not considered to be a question, but it's an area. Like, how do you end up predicting computationally? Starting from a sequence, how do you predict the final structure of the protein? Where a lot of physics and chemistry is involved in it, and various techniques have been developed. Some of them are called ab initio techniques, where you consider the physics coming into the picture, what kind of attractive forces two atoms and therefore molecules have between them, and thereby can we actually predict, simulate how a protein chain will end up folding at different time points, eventually folding into its three-dimensional structure. That's an ab initio technique of doing it, which is very, very cumbersome. In fact, it is estimated that even with the existing computational power that we have, it for a simple protein of only a few hundred amino acids to fold it, it will take us centuries to fold it, right? And that is where the challenge comes. Can we actually make it better? And the second is so-called knowledge-driven methods, wherein you already know a lot of protein sequences, and you already know their protein structures which are available. Databases which have been created over a period of time by looking at crystal structures, such as this one, they make us available the three-dimensional structure. Knowing that this is the sequence and this is the corresponding structure to it, can we derive some rules based on that? So that we could be able to say that there is a certain pattern from the sequence which correspondingly leads to a three-dimensional structure of a certain type of a fold. If we could do that, that would be called as a knowledge-based protein folding method. So that's another problem which is still open. While we do have good computational tools available today, which allow us to accurately predict the folds of very simple proteins, this problem has not been fully solved. And remember that, as I am telling you, that the cost of sequencing is going down, therefore, there are lots of living entities around us, starting from beetle, bacteria, viruses, plants, etc., where a lot of interesting things are living there. We might want to get a drug out of a particular plant, or if you might want to engineer a particular bacteria to do something else than it is otherwise doing, right? So toxic chemicals, can I design a bacteria which can actually consume toxic chemicals, but then if it is not naturally doing it, can I tweak it somehow? Okay, can I have a plant which is growing in adverse conditions, having less water in a drought-like condition? Can I make it do that? For that, I will have to tweak it. For that, first I will have to read the genome sequence, understand it at the level of structures also, to be able to do that genetic engineering, as it is called. So, well, this is another question at the level of structure and structure prediction, and even trying to look at how these structures interact with each other, so as to give the final form of the function. To highlight the fact that, yes, it is a very difficult problem, the protein structure prediction, I'm just telling you that, why do we need to do it if you could do it experimentally? Doing it experimentally needs the help of techniques such as NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance, as well as X-ray crystallography. And before doing that, we need to have what is called as a crystal formed of a given protein. And that process is random. Even now, crystallographers across the world, they try to crystallize various proteins in the hope of finally getting their three-dimensional structure through methods such as X-ray crystallography. It's a very tough challenge because, as I told you, that the scientists, rational scientists, they say that after you apply a certain, create a certain buffer for crystallizing a protein, you pray your favorite deity so that it crystallizes, so that you can get the structure out of it. And the problem is so important that, of course, this is a very big problem, that is that of a ribosome molecule. If you want to get a structure, a Nobel Prize was given because this is such an important molecule. This is the molecule which is responsible for creating all the protein structures within our living cell, right? And this gentleman, you may remember, Venkat Raman Ramakrishnan, who is an Indian origin scientist who recently got a Nobel Prize, part of the Nobel Prize for discovering this structure. Well, that was a very brief summary. I hope I have been able to give you a grasp of what is a cell, what are the different components available in it. I'm not naming a lot of them, like a mitochondria or endoplasmic reticulum, etc., without getting into the complex names. The basic phenomena which involves information transfer is that of DNA, which is sitting in the nucleus. The sum total is called genome. It's getting converted into its corresponding mRNA, the functional part of it. These mRNAs are further converted into corresponding protein chains, which seemingly magically fold into their, in the appropriate ambience, suitable ambience, they fold into its functional forms, the three-dimensional forms, and they're wiggling around within the cell doing the functions because of which living things are living, right? So that's the crux of the matter, as we understand, thanks to a lot of work that has been done by biologists through experimental studies. It has taken a lot of time for them to get into, get us this knowledge today, right? Okay. Yeah, please. Yes. Any other biomolecule? Okay, the question is whether DNA is required only for creation of proteins, or is it required for anything else also? Everything else, every biomolecule which is made in the cell, including the so-called fats, lipids, etc., they are all created through a web, mishmash of what are called as pathways, molecular pathways. So a small product which is acted upon by one enzyme, which is nothing but your protein, by the way, enzyme is a kind of a protein, acting on it, converting into another kind of a molecule, further into another molecule. That's why it's called a pathway, a molecular pathway, eventually creating either one of the molecules which we needed, including fat, or consuming the glucose that we are taking and converting into some other form. So the whole cell acts as a transformation machinery, which is converting molecules from one form to another form, eventually so that the cell survives and can do its function. So all of these enzymes which are required, proteins which are required, they are all created through genes. So yes, indirectly they are affecting synthesis of fat or other biomolecules. I hope that answers your question. So indeed, everything that is happening within the cell essentially boils down to the genome, because everything is coded there. First of all, regardless of the fact that a very evolved and complex organism such as human being versus that of a simple bacteria, we do have lots of different types of cells and tissues within our body. The genome in principle is the same. What changes is the expression level, as it is called. Like, imagine for the sake of simplicity that we have 10 genes, okay? The number of mRNAs which are produced for every gene might change from situation to situation, whether it is present in a kidney or a liver in a simplistic manner, right? So yes, the genome remains the same, but the pattern of expression, as it is called, the transcripts which are made from gene to mRNA and therefore the proteins, that changes the basic nature and character of a cell. A cell could work as a kidney cell or that of a heart cell or a brain cell, depending on where it is, its morphology and the function. Thanks to the amount expression it is doing. So the variability is coming because of the functioning part. The genome remains practically the same, right? Okay, so now I'll tell you that how, for example, if I were to be a biologist, I mean, all of us are biologists, as I said, because we are asking these questions about living entities, and we also are ruled by the so-called reductionist paradigm, that if I were to break these entities into small pieces and understand one small part of it, I'll be able to understand the whole entity if I were to put them together, right? So if I understand the properties of a transistor, capacitor, and a resistor probably, and if I make a simple LC circuit out of it, and if I were to write the differential equations, then I should be able to predict what is the response of this system. Does that make sense, right? That is the kind of a reductionist paradigm that we have been living under, and physics, that's like more like a dominated by physics entity, remember. But I told you that biological entities are not so easy. As it is said, you know, the cat is not the same as a washing machine, right? So that's a paradigm, that's a kind of a philosophy I would like to impress upon you. And ask this question, can a biologist thinking from a reductionist paradigm fix a radio? So the biologists who had found this radio, in this case I'll take a specific you know, question, that of a disease, in this case cancer. All of us are aware of what is a cancer. It's a malignant growth of a cell which eventually becomes fatal for us, right? So we are trying to understand cancer and have not understood till date. This is the question which bugged one cancer scientist called Yuri Lazibnik, who had a look at you know, a scenario, what's happening in cancer research in general, and the way research is being done, and cooked up this hilarious story about a cancer scientist trying to look at a cancer cell seems very much similar to a biologist looking at a radio and trying to understand its mechanism or fix it for that matter, right? So cancer, over a period of time, decades of research has revealed, has lots of interesting mishmash and a web of molecular interactions that are happening inside it. Okay, so this is our cellular membrane, the one which is the outside pocket, and you have the nucleus inside it, right? And there are lots of molecules, each of them is actually a protein, the green ones, and they are interacting with each other through so-called activation reactions or inhibitory reactions, such as these ones. And well, cancer seems to have the so-called hallmark features, the basic telltale features, molecular reactions, which are responsible for cancer. So it looks very complex, right? This is how it is. And this is not very different from that of a radio, I will argue for that. So a person who is looking at a radio and who wants to understand A, about how radio works, or B, if it goes wrong, tries to fix it. If a biologist were to do it with his or her philosophy, how would they do it? So a biologist would actually write a fund, write for a fund asking for a lot of money so that he or she can buy lots of radios, first of all. Buy lots of radios, first of all, right? And then ask for tools such as screwdrivers or some other things probably by which you can open it, remember? Because cells are not transparent for you. You'll have to open it some way. It's over the period of time, technologies such as microscope and, you know, staining as it is called, etc., have made the inside of the cells visible to us, right? That has taken a long time for us. But let us say if I were to do that as a biologist, I would actually need a lot of money to open them up, right? I'll open them up and hang them on the walls. You would ask me why. After that, I would also buy lots of pebbles. I'll actually pay money for that. I'll buy lots of pebbles, stand at a distance, and to be able to understand how the radio works, what I would do is that I'll take a pebble and throw the stone on this electronic circuitry, right? It'll hit somewhere. And when I turn on the radio, something would have happened, hopefully, compared to its normal function. Let's assume, for example, that, you know, static increases, something like that. And the one biologist, because there are lots of biologists who are doing similar kind of research across the world on radios trying to understand how it works, one of the biologists would write a paper saying that this component, when hit upon, actually creates this malfunction. The static increases. Therefore, he or she will write a paper saying that this particular part of the component is the seriously most important component. And because to make communication easy, he or she will call it SRC. SRC is the most important component responsible for specifying static noise in radio. That will be the title of the paper. Another biologist who is doing similar exercise with painstaking efforts, remember, you have to open the radios, hang them on the wall, throw the stone, measure the properties, compare the properties with that of the wild type radio, as they call it. Wild type is normal, by the way. Okay, function. And they'll say, okay, there is something else which is coming up here. When you hit upon this, something happens. For example, the reception goes bad, something, some malfunctioning in radio. And he or she will call it really important component and will publish in another big journal. Right, and as again, we'll create an acronym for it. Similarly, the story goes, somebody else will come up and saying that, forget about your SRCs and RICs, I have got the most important component here. And somebody else will come and say that, forget about all of you, I've got the undoubtedly most important component, the mix and the U-mix. And the story goes on. What's happening here? What's happening is that without appreciating the fact that all of these entities are working in sync with each other, it's a complex system, interacting system. If I forget that part and consider them to be independent entities, I will make this mistake of using a reductionist paradigm in understanding, or rather connecting, a component to a function. This gene causes cancer. That gene makes you fat. This gene makes you lose hair. Not so simple. Had it been so simple, I would have fixed it. Right? Okay. So that's what is happening here. It's like an elephant and a blind man problem. That it's a complex system without understanding individual, not only that we need understanding of individual entities that are there, but also we need to understand how they interact with each other, how do they talk to each other, how do they communicate with each other, talking in the language of signal information transfer or signal transduction, right? We need to understand that. And we have a long way to go because it's evolutionary mechanism, tinkering, which has led us to where we are right now. To understand what might have happened is like looking into the past through the molecular machinery that we have today. That's the job we are stuck with. That's the job a typical reductionist biologist is stuck with now. So in the last decade or two, people have realized that this is an important paradigm, the so-called systems paradigm with which we need to approach the world, A, and as opposed to electronics engineer or a simple radio mechanic, what differently is happening is that we need to have a detailed map of how things are interacting and the rules for each of them to be able to say that, okay, if this goes wrong, probably this is what you need to do, a troubleshooting mechanism, and this is a fix available for it. That's what we need to do. So the proposal that was given by Yuri Lazebnik, a cancer scientist, was that as opposed to looking at biological entities like this, trying to create very cartoonistic kind of a map, we need to create a detailed map understanding the variations in different kind of entities which are forming the radio and thereby trying to get a solution out of it. In this case, we are trying to address problem of cancer or any disease for that matter. How does it happen? As long as it has got a genetic basis, basis which is there at the molecular level in the cell. Okay, that's what we are trying to do. Right, so to extend the picture that we had of the central dogma of molecular biology, which tells us of information transfer happening from DNA to RNA to corresponding protein, we are now saying that it's not only these stops here, but we need to consider each of these biomolecules sitting here and interacting with each other. Because remember that even protein go and bind to the DNA and lead to their so-called transcription, the creation of mRNA. So it's all a intermixed web. So we need to understand this, right? So this is a proposal of looking at biological entities, complex system, from a systems perspective, right? So from that perspective, it seems that otherwise a medical researcher or doctor would have looked in the 20th century at a disease as a standalone thing, even at the level of genetic level, that even if I were to say that there is gene responsible for a disease such as that of a cancer, I would have said that a particular gene is responsible for it. But the moment you put all the diseases, each circle is a disease here, by the way, okay, and the color tells us about what category of disease does it belong to. For example, these are all cancers. Here you have retinal pigmentosa, etc. So these they are colored according to the type of the disease that I have. And a line between the two tells us that do they share the genetic basis? Are there same molecules, genes, which are responsible for both the diseases? Commonly, is that what, that's what you are asking this question. And the moment you do that, you will get a very nice interconnected picture indicating that a complex system would actually behave like this, right? You would have all these interconnections and they will be unpredictable. You see that often because of the emergent phenomena that might be happening, right? So this is the picture that we have. Now we realize that we need to look at the diseases from various perspectives. One of the perspectives is to look at all kind of molecules that are there in the cell and how are they interacting with each other, such as metabolic network, protein-protein interaction network, and other kind of gene regulations that are happening. So it's a heterogeneous bunch of molecules regulating with each other, creating such kind of a electronic circuitry out here. That's one thing. We need to look at how the diseases are connected with each other to find out whether if you where to make changes or modification at one disease, what will happen, probably what kind of other implications that it might create. And not to mention, sounds a little strange, but yes, whether the social networks that we have, do they have any contribution to make in that? Okay, I won't touch upon this unless somebody has a question about it, but many diseases seem to have some bearing on the social network, right? So essentially, we can look at various data that is available from biological systems from an interconnected perspective. Now, this was about understanding disease. Now, the next part is, can we control diseases? Since we have taken that as a case study, disease being a complex system. Well, the conventional way by which we try to control diseases is, for example, is to change your food, right? If you are having diarrhea, maybe you shouldn't eat this, or if you are having maybe some other problem, then you eat this, etc. Those are the mechanisms. Or using plant products, which is what conventionally we have been doing across the globe, by the way, right? And of course, latest pharmacological science tells us that it is possible for us to have drugs which we can consume and by which we can have a solution for some of the problems that we have, right? Some of the diseases that we have. But this process is extremely time consuming and laborious. Starting from a large number of potential compounds, you need to go through preclinical, clinical trials and make sure that the drug is actually effective and is not causing any adverse reactions. To finally, after testing through lots of, going through lots of stages, you can actually come at a solution, a particular drug which is effective, right? Given the nature, given the fact that molecular entities are interconnected with each other, it, in retrospect, it should now sound to us that a drug may not work without any adverse reactions. You see that? So now the question is, how do you get drugs which are effective against a particular disorder as much as possible, as specific as possible, at the same time do not cause any adverse reactions? Can we do that? And that's a standing problem. Given the fact that we have the data of molecules which are participating in, this, in the cell, not only that, disease-specific molecules, and we have data about drugs and their side effects and which are the enzymes do they go and bind to. If all this information is given to you as an information scientist, as a computer scientist, can we try solving this problem of finding out a better drug, as well as more importantly being, you know, you can act smart and say that, look, I would like to in fact find a drug which has been already approved by FDA, therefore it doesn't have any harmful effects, and use it for some other purpose. It's called repurposing. Okay, can I reposition a drug using the existing information? So these are another question that we can ask. So this is a map of various drugs and protein interactions that are happening, right? This is to give you another network picture, okay, of drugs and targets. Now the next paradigm, apart from the disease that I would like to touch upon as a radio, is that of brain. We've been trying to understand brain, you know, in terms of what kind of various cognitive processes, language, etc., or hearing, seeing, etc., the brain and different parts of the brain are responsible. And to touch base with so-called consciousness, one of the proposals that has been made is that essentially everything that we can connect with brain consciousness can be finally pinned down to the hardware, the neuronal circuitry that we have. So this is a proposal by none other than Francis Crick, who was one of the co-discoverers of DNA structure, saying that it's called as an astonishing hypothesis by himself through a book that he wrote, that all of our joys, sorrows, memories, ambitions, sense of personal identity and free will are in fact no more than the behavior of vast assembly of nerve cells and their associated molecules. Now this goes like a reductionist phenomena. You see that we are trying to pin down everything. There is nothing called soul according to this paradigm, by the way, right? Well, highly debatable. But the question is, can we actually understand in a brain in a better manner? Similar to molecular connections, can we actually create a picture, circuitry of the brain? Well, this is a new proposal and things are working according to this. Can we create the underlying networks of physical connections between the neuron and understand it? It has been difficult for us to get that map, but recently, thanks to many projects that are happening, such as that of the connectome, human connectome project, we are getting more and more data. Right? Although it is at a nascent stage, we believe that a lot of interesting things can be done even at this level. Deliberately, I chose these two questions and problems of diseases and brain to tell you that, okay, one which is practical and other which is also practical, but at the same time it can touch upon a very, very existential questions about who am I, how do I think, you know, those are the questions which are in fact sometimes dealt upon at the spiritual level. Can we ask this question and try to answer them? Okay, using the paradigm of computational biology. Notice, the moment you get the data, Now we have lots of interesting questions to ask, which can be solved with the help of computational techniques by writing algorithms and generating hypotheses to test those answers that are coming from computational studies, right? Okay, so various challenges and opportunities are lying in front of this. The practical one, that genomics, proteomics, transcriptomics, which is nothing but the mRNA expression level, which is making a cell different from another one. Metabolomics, how metabolites interact with each other, etc. All this is broadly called as the omics area, right? Wherein the data is becoming available for plants and animals equally. And what are the different algorithms and strategies that can be used for analyzing this data, for better understanding this data, right? To decode what has evolution has already encoded into the living entities and their functions. Of course, a lot of machine learning can be applied at different levels. Genome assembly being a problem, alignment, we talked about it, and a huge amount of data analytics. Thanks to various sensors, internet, and Internet of Things, now we can get a lot of data of heart rate, how is it varying, how the glucose level is changing automatically. A huge stream of data can be generated from a large number of people. Can we use it for doing some predictive medical informatics so that we can propose that, okay, such kind of changes are hazardous, so this person needs an attention from a medical expert. Can we do that? So people are trying to do that and enter into the area of health informatics. Classical problems such as protein folding, gene identification, databases, how do you actually curate and collect this data so that it can be effectively analyzed, as well as area of drug discovery where docking simulation can be done, and for that matter even looking at the data of looking at side effects and predicting and repurposing. So this is, in a single shot, I'm trying to present you various known challenges, some of them which I've actually got into the details of it, rest of them I couldn't, of course, and opportunities, because I believe as the way things are going, definitely biology has changed, it has become a data science. And therefore, all of us who are, you know, having analytical bent of mind and would like to use, you know, programming and computer science for solving our problems, you are biologists all of a sudden. And biologists who hopefully by now, in the last half an hour, have an understanding that it's not so straightforward, there are complex systems, they are interconnected. So maybe we need to ask questions from that perspective, okay? Quickly, I'll just summarize this work to tell you about how machine learning has been used. Very interesting problem. And this touches upon, by the way, of so-called personalized medicine. Okay, if I were to ask a doctor what drug should I take, these days we get generic suggestion about you should take so-and-so drug so that you can get cured of this disease. But most of the times they don't work equally well on everybody. The reason being that we are variable. Despite the fact that our genomes are 99.9% or more than that similar, we would have various differing response to the same drug. Can we actually come up with personalized solutions for individuals? That's the question. Now, this is about the so-called dietary recommendation. In this case, knowing the fact, the question that was dealt with was that the so-called postprandial glucose response. Like, what is the extent by which the glucose increases, which is related to diabetes, by the way, after I take a certain food? So instead of having generic suggestions about take this or don't take this, can I make it more personal? That's the question which was asked. Very interesting study, published in a very, very respected journal and rigorously done. Knowing that food that we eat and the so-called glucose response has basis in lots of interesting things, and it can show up in the blood test as well as the gut microbiome, the kind of microbiomes that are living in our gut. All this data was collected, machine learning technique was applied, and it was tested, trained with the help of 800 participants' data over a period of time, few months. And after that, the machine, now the neural network, is ready to make predictions. So they tested the predictions with so-called 100 participants' validation cohort, where they asked this question that if I were to standardize food, which is already being tested here, if I were to provide this food, what is the predicted level of postprandial glucose level? That is, after eating food, how much glucose will increase? And this, it was reported, could predict very, very accurately, right? Now, we are entering into the zone where can we actually do this effectively for individuals and actually produce dietary recommendations. Therefore, a typical dietitian is replaced by a machine learning program. See that? So that's where I guess very interesting things are happening. And this is a, you know, I think burning problem for many of us, because we would like to interfere with the progression of diabetes and for that matter, other diseases which are connected with diet. So this was a single case study that I presented with the hope that this will excite you, that machine learning can be applied to a problem which seems as complex as this, because we don't understand how diet actually goes and interacts with our genome in a very clearer manner. Okay, that's where new areas are coming up. Right. So with this, we have completed two parts. One, that of understanding the basics in terms of molecular biology and central dogma, and how it has got extended thanks to the failure that we know a typical reductionist biologist would end up getting into if he or she tries to understand a complex system such as a cell, a disease, or brain for that matter, the functioning of the brain. Now, what I would like to do is to, provide a glimpse of the work that we are doing. I'll quickly run through the work that is touching upon some of the questions that I asked just now in the previous part, and finally will tell you, which I hope you would be interested, is about the discovery of a new phenomena of food pairing, which broadly tries to tell us that okay, there is a mechanism, molecular level mechanism within the food, behind the food that we eat, the Indian cuisine. That's what we ended up studying. So we look at biological complex systems, that's why it's called a complex systems laboratory, and these systems, like a radio, are comprising of large number of sophisticated functional elements which are subtly interconnected with each other, and they give rise to various functions which are otherwise cannot be executed by individual parts. So these are having emergent properties, right? Therefore, some of the parts is not the same as the whole. That's the paradigm that we are touching upon here, and we use graph theory, the network analysis as it is called, by looking at data available. Notice that we don't do experimental work. Rather, I have not done experimental work with my students so far. So we are looking at the data which is already available to us, and at times when required, we collaborate with experimental researchers to ensure that our predictions are tested through the experimental work. Now this paradigm can be applied on biological entities which are as small as protein structures, nanometer level, as well as micrometer level, such as those of a cell. I told you the dimension of a typical cell is approximately few micrometers, and even brain networks, and maybe all the up to the level of food webs, how species interact with each other, right? We have already worked at multiple levels, and now we have research done at these levels also, right? So the basic philosophy is look at the data, collect the data as accurately as possible, make sure that there are no, as less noise as possible, importantly. Model this data with the help of this network model that we are proposing, the integrative models that we are proposing. Find ways, having understood and tried to model a disease for that matter, find ways of controlling it. What is the best way to control a disease? Try to find out that, and maybe, 15 years down the line, 20 years down the line, can we learn from biological systems? As opposed to designing electronic circuitry the way they are designed today, can we learn from biological systems? That's a question. It's an open question. But maybe it is not applicable in the domain of electronic circuitry, or maybe it is. It's a good, important question to ask. Can the system be designed, not only electronic circuitry, but other engineering system, which can be robust as biological systems are known to be, many of them? Yeah, that's the question we are trying to ask in the design part of it, although it's a long stretch. So our work deals with on the interface of computation and biology and medicine, right? So one part which I did from my PhD level onwards is that look at the protein structures, the three-dimensional structure that I told you about, right? And the detailed data that is available, instead of trying to solve the problem of how the protein folds, what I tried to do is that look at the existing protein structures, model them as networks of connections between amino acids, and try to infer something interesting out of it. From that, we found that it has got some interesting properties which are known to be also reported in various other network systems from physics, social sciences, etc., the so-called small world network phenomena, as well as some other interesting properties that we have found in protein structures which are not present in many other networks. Importantly, using the same paradigm, we actually could use it for engineering a thermostable enzyme which is used for various applications, the superoxidase dismutase as it is called, including preservation. But the problem with this particular enzyme was that it was not stable at high temperatures. So the idea was, can we make some change at the level of amino acid, a small change part of the protein, so that it can change its function. It is able to do its job otherwise, but is also able to be stable and functional at high temperatures. That's what we tried to do. And we were successful in creating, in fact, a protein which is stable at very high temperatures. So in principle, this can be used for preserving hapus, for example, the mangoes, which are exported through the ship across the world. Well, the next question that we are asking, this was about protein structure modeling. Then trying to look at the diseases, we are asking various questions, that why diseases? Why do they happen? What kind of modeling can we do? I already have answered that question using interactomes and expression data. And what are the ways of controlling it? Right? So we have done studies of cancer, metastasis, asthma and diabetes to model such networks and trying to identify the regulatory mechanisms which are through which we can control the disease. Have you found an answer to that fully? Not yet. Have you found a drug which is effective? Not really so far, but we are trying to do that. Overall, I will summarize this area that on which we have worked for the last 5 years after I'm back from Max Planck, my postdoc, is that we have tried to look at diseases as interactomes, the networks, and also interestingly, we are trying to connect it with the traditional medicinal system. In traditional medicinal system, we already know the efficacy of certain plants, which has been empirically tested. In which case, can we use this information to collect the collect the data of molecules which are present in different plants? In this case, serpentina, which many of you might have heard called sarpagandha in Indian system. Create the databases, structured databases of these molecules. So we have done it for 6 plants, including serpentina, 5 other medicinal plants from Himalayas, which are reported in the Ayurvedic medicine system. And further, using the techniques of docking, virtual screening as it is called, as opposed to doing the screening in the laboratory, can we do it in the computers? With the existing tools, we did not design any new tool, but you use the existing tools of virtual screening. And finally, to predict certain molecules which are probably effective against a certain disorder. We did this, and in this case, we have found a few molecules which are predicted to be effective against an enzyme called aldose reductase, which is known to be important for diabetes complications. Now we are testing it with the help of a collaborator to see at in vitro level in the test tube whether it is effective or not, so that if it is so, if we are successful at that level, then we can move into the so-called in vivo testing. Right? So, well, this is one part of the work that we have done. And another one is that of the cell, which is a complex mishmash of interacting molecules, and we know the drugs. Interestingly, we have the databases available about which drug is known to go and bind to a particular enzyme. Which enzyme or protein does it go and bind? We have that information. We also have information about this particular drug is known to cause certain set of side effects. Okay, there is a large repertoire of side effects of the order of 4,500 or so, starting from headache, nausea, dizziness to death. Surprisingly, it's a side effect. I didn't know that. A very rare one, but that it is there. We have this data. What do we do with that now? Can we apply some machine learning techniques to learn from it? That what kind of features are available from the drugs? Essentially, it's the chemical features which are eventually responsible for whatever effect that they are doing. Binding to certain molecule, causing a certain side effect. Can we create a framework where we can integrate all this data to predict side effects? So as a first effort, we have published a paper in Molecular Biosystems with the help of a computer science student. It's a Royal Society of Chemistry journal where, you know, it's a contribution to the existing body of the work, and we are trying to improvise upon this work. Okay? And of course, if we can repurpose the existing drugs. Okay? So one of the classic case of existing drug repositioning is that of Viagra. When it was proposed for the first time, it was meant for something else. It was related to a heart ailment. But later it was found as a side effect. It can be used as Viagra, and it was repurposed. Well, can we do it for some other drugs also? A lot of them. If you could do that with the help of the data that is available and the, you know, machine learning tools, that would be wonderful, right? Okay, so in summary, the kind of work that we are doing deals with asking hypothesis-driven questions, kind of knowledge generation, also creating databases, which we are trying to do it. You know, I have been impressed with this fact that I don't want to just do theoretical work. I would like to use it, find some good, interesting application for the same. So we are creating these databases, making it openly available so that people can actually go through these 6 medicinal plants, Himalayan medicinal plants that we have collected and their chemicals, so that if they want to do some drug discovery studies, they're happy to go ahead and do that. And if possible, create applications out of it. Drug being one of the interesting applications, of course. And if there is anything else that can come out of it. Well, towards... Yes, please. Okay, that's an interesting question. As I said, we do not do experiments. So the question is that did I create this data from my own experimental work, right? So answer to this question for me is no, I did not do that. But what I'm saying is this is secondary data. For example, we know that existing knowledge of plants, what molecules are there, they are already reported in various large number of thousands of papers. What we did is to scan through these papers using simple techniques of natural language processing and collect these molecules, curate them, and create this database. Of course, when we created database, we asked a question, like in the case of serpentina. I already know that serpentina root extracts are known to be effective against diabetes also, apart from the fact that it is known to be a classic drug for hypertension. There is a classic drug coming from serpentina for hypertension. So we had this report. What we did is we collected the database of, turned out that there are 137 molecules which are so far reported. We might have missed some, but these are the ones definitely there, right? Using that, we created a structured database. When I say structured, name of the molecule, chemical name, so-called IUPAC, SMILE ID, etc., chemical features, all that. Having done that, we went back to the problem and said that, okay, there is a protein, aldose reductase, which is known to be very, very crucial. It's a bottleneck molecule for glucose metabolism. So we said, okay, probably this is effective. That's bridging the traditional and modern medicine. Probably this might be effective. This plant and these molecules might be effective against this enzyme. So we did the so-called virtual screening, molecular dynamic studies, and further rigorous analysis to figure out that, yes, there are three molecules that we are predicting. So that's what we are doing here. We are not ourselves generating data and creating databases. We are sometimes creating secondary databases, as I'm saying here, and sometimes we are compiling the data which is existing available there and putting it up there. Okay, right. Contrary reports. Good question. The question is that when you look at research, you get contradictory reports of this being effective against something or not effective against something. In which case, knowing the fact that repetition of any scientific evidence is very, very important, we take only that which is consistently repeated and confirmed, right? And whenever there is a contradiction, you can give a scoring scheme, you see that, for such kind of data, that these two proteins are interacting, no, they are not interacting, etc. So there is a, given the nature of the data, you might end up getting a lot of false positives in some kind of data. So you are right. The nature of experimental technique which has been used for generating data has to be kept in mind while you are curating data. We do that. We use some confirmatory ways of compiling this data and scoring scheme so as to create as accurate data as possible, because notice, if your network or the systems picture is wrong, the answers are going to be terribly wrong, right? So we have to be careful. We try to do that. I can't say that we are at a level where we have achieved a state of the art. Nothing like that. A lot of efforts are happening. And again, you know, a lot of computational techniques could be useful here in trying to find the as accurate data as possible. Okay? All right. So now I'll, in the next 10 to 10 minutes or so, I'll wind up. Yes, please. You have a question. Correct. I agree. So the question that is being raised is that given a drug, its effect on individuals could be different. Therefore, a database that, such as the one which I told, could be erroneous in terms of not having correct representation of the side effects. Right? That's true. So what is being done in this case is that two types of data is collected. One, which is reported by the drug discovery company, the pharmaceutical company or any company which is involved in that. At the time of trial, what kind of side effects were reported by the participants? That's one. Second, after the drug is actually used on a mass scale on the patients report certain side effects. All that is compiled together. And this, even after this, it's noisy. I agree with that. So we do not have personalized information of the side effect, and it's difficult to get it. Do you agree? That I can't take 100 types of drugs and test it on me just because I want to generate data out of me. But what I can do is that I can find out what are the possible factors, features in me which are responding to a drug. create a database similar to that of the food. You see that? Like whether I take a banana or a cookie, how does my body respond? I know various factors within my body, including the microbiome which is responsible for it, and come up with a technique possibly, such as the case of machine learning technique which has been used here, to come up with an answer to that question. So right now when we are looking at drug side effect, we are not looking at personalized medicine, no. In this particular question that I raised, it was about general use of a drug. A particular drug, broadly speaking, it can be effective against a certain disorder. That I can say. Whether it is going to be solution for you or me or not, we cannot say right now because, as you said, the quality of the data is not so good at the moment. So your point is valid. Personalized medicine using the technique that I told you with the kind of data available is not possible. That's how it is. Yes, we can't generalize the data, but if a certain drug has gone through, the drug discovery pipeline has been approved, probably it is means that it is applicable or it is useful against a large number of people. Do you get that? At least, so that information is available without which it doesn't get approved. FDA is a very strict protocol. That's why it takes of the order of 14 to 15 years for a drug to come out starting from the starting line, right? So maybe I can touch back to it again. Let me just complete this last bit that I have about the research coming out of our lab. Now this is something which I don't know whether many people say is this computational biology or no, I don't know. But the kind of exploration that I've been doing, as I told you, given the training and the mindset that I have, I try to look at interesting questions. And you know, if there are some interesting questions, I try to address them, right? So this was one of the interesting questions where we looked at food, ingredients which are used in food, I'm talking about recipes, literally recipes, ingredients which are used in recipes, molecules which are present in those ingredients, which is why it is making we are using them, probably. There is a reason for it, right? And is there a pattern in it? That's what we looked. We found a pattern, and we found that this pattern is very, very unique and different in Indian cuisine versus that of Latin American, North American, Eastern European, and Southern European cuisines. The so-called Western cuisine versus that of Indian cuisine, we found it's very, very different. So you said it's obvious. Said, yes, it's obvious, but we have proven it at the level of quantified level, at the level of molecules. That's all I'm saying. And this was the research which was identified as emerging technology by MIT Technology Review and was all over the place and trending number one on Facebook on 4th of March 2015 for 1.5 or 2 days. So that's the research I'll be talking about very quickly. What did we do? Well, we already knew that there is something called food pairing, that in a recipe, if there are two ingredients which are being used, chefs, in this case, a chef, very popular chef, celebrity chef called Blumenthal, UK chef, he proposed that, look, it looks like if there are two ingredients and if this ingredient, like onion has got certain molecules in it, you know, flavor molecules because of which it tastes the way it tastes and the smells the way it smells. Similarly, maybe coconut, if I take another example. If they are similar in terms of their flavor profile, taste, smell, then they will go better in a recipe. That's the proposition which was made, which essentially says that ingredient sharing flavor compounds are more likely to taste well together than those which do not. That was the proposal. And it was tested with the data of recipes, the traditional recipes which have got logged into our cultural rubric, right? Recipes, ingredients which are present in them, and the molecules in them. When they looked at it, they found that indeed, compared to a randomized cuisine which can be created with the same number of ingredients, same number of recipes and same size distribution, because every recipe has got a size in the sense how many ingredients are there, 5, 8, 10, 30 or 40, etc. If you look at it, looks like there is a pattern there, there is a bias. The traditional recipes are getting into a direction where you tend to use ingredients which are similar to each other. Now this is a bunch of molecules, this is a Venn diagram. This represents a set of molecules and this is another set of molecules, flavor molecules, and the overlap between the two. More the overlap, more is the probability that they will be used in a given cuisine. That was what was shown for the North American, Latin American and European cuisines. When I was teaching this, a course on complex networks in IIT Jodhpur, I got, you know, something, a weird idea in my mind. This is Indian cuisine is not going to fit into this pattern, it's not going to match at all for many reasons. The cultural diversity, geographic diversity, climatic diversity, and it doesn't fit into, somehow intuitionally it hit me that it's not going to work like this, right? It took a long time because this is not conventional work, you see. All of a sudden, other than talking about proteins, drug, side effect, algorithms, programming, all of a sudden in the home I'm talking with my PhD student, you know that recipe, tarla dalal, etc. So my wife got worried, what are you doing exactly? Okay, so that's the kind of a diversion that I took here. And well, India has got, you know, history of health-centric dietary practices. Not to say that India is the only country of doing that sort. Many oriental cultures, including China, Korea, etc., Southeast Asian countries have this trend, you know, using food as an intervention mechanism for various problems that we might have or even for health purpose. And there are recorded evidence about how food has been used as a medicinal agent, kind of, right? But there is a huge difference in the conventional medicine drug, which is taken in a high concentration at a spike kind of a thing, as opposed to the food which we naturally keep on consuming on a regular basis. You see that? Right. So, well, we had to collect data. So, where do you get this data? Traditional recipes. Well, you'll have to go to a bookshelf and you pick up a recipe book and do that, right? But we were not of the type who will do that. So I had a computer science student, MTech computer science student, who was doing a project, and another MA linguistic student who is working on a natural language processing with me, Rakhi and Anupam, and we started stealing the data. We went to various data repertoires and we literally scraped the data from there and made sure that all data is correct in terms of recipe, its name, and what are the ingredients used in, and the procedure for that. We ignored the procedure part of it for the moment. It's a very simplistic study, by the way. Okay? So, incidentally, I don't have to vouch for it that the data of Indian recipes that we took is well tested. We are all here. Grandfathers, grandmothers, everything, everybody consumed it over a period of time, traditional recipes, and they all survived, you know, in a big way, until at least, you know, for a long age, until they were reproductive. Second, they are well tested. Well, I don't have to vouch for it. I would say that all of us agree with that primarily, and the world agrees with that. We took the data of recipes. So each of these food is, for example, let's say this bhindi thing is a recipe. So you take bhindi, you take some cumin, turmeric, etc., you mix them together. That becomes your recipe, right? And of course, ingredients. Ingredients of different types, okay? Vegetables, non-vegetables, and you have fruits, you have spices, etc. All kind of ingredients which are being used here. I'll tell you the categories. And the question that we asked, apart from recipes, notice that this recipes data is very important, because this is traditional recipe tells us its fitness of a recipe, that it has survived over a long period of time for maybe taste reason and maybe health reason, both maybe. It's a combination of both. Okay? We wanted to look at the molecular level. What causes a particular ingredient to be quote unquote used to be fit? So we said it's taste eventually. We are not responding only for its shape, for example. You see that? We don't eat any ingredient just because it is 1 centimeter in diameter. Right? We eat it because, well, it tastes the way it tastes, the way it smells the way it smells. So we took only two factors. That is the so-called smell factor, which is olfactory mechanisms, as it is called in biology, and gustatory mechanism through which we taste things. Right? So we called it flavor. And it's got a, you know, weird, wide combination of flavors that we can have. Started from these 194 ingredients that we aliased this way, like chopped potato, baked potato is potato. Right? Although we know that there can be transformations, let's ignore that for the moment. Let's keep it simple. So we have these ingredients, all types of them, categorized into animal products, beverage, dairy, fish, flour, fruit, herb, meat, plant, etc. 15 to 16 different categories. We ignored one additive. There is a reason for that. So 15 different categories. And we looked at their flavor profile sizes, like spice, what is the number of molecules which are reported to be there, flavor molecules. So when you look at the size, this is just to show that there is no bias in the data. Every size of a size, every basket of the size has got all kind of different types of ingredients fitting into that. Importantly, we compile 1170 molecules. Again, to repeat the question, like, did you actually, you know, crush cumin and figure out what molecule it is? Not really. I don't have to do it. People have done it already. There are too many biologists hanging their radios on the wall and reporting it. I don't have to do that. Similar to that, there are enough chemists doing this job. I had to compile it and we make very sure that my data is accurate. I did that, okay, with the help of my students. Flavor ingredients and molecules reported in the book as well as from the web sourced. We did that. And compilation was done. Well, there you go. You have the data with us. And it's all computational, because I was asked this question that out of the 2,543 recipes, how many did you cook? I said, none. I didn't do that. Okay, but we have been cooking. All of us have been doing cooking these recipes. So we have recipes 1, 2, 3, all the way up to, let's say, 2,543. Each dish represents one recipe. Let me take one recipe out of it, coconut chutney, and break it into parts. For simplicity, South Indians don't get insulted. It's a complicated recipe having 17 or so ingredients, but let's say it has only got, you know, coconut, onion, red chili, and curry leaf. Now, I know the definition of food pairing. So what I would do is that, for this particular recipe, 4 ingredients and all pairs, obviously NCU2 pairs I will have, right? So for every pair, I'll compute number of shared molecules. That's a number. Then I find the average of paired molecules in a given recipe, right? So that will be a simple number telling 5.3 molecules on an average in a given recipe, for example, right? After finding this so-called NSR, number of shared molecules in a recipe, I'll find out the average number of molecules shared across all the recipes. That's one number for the whole cuisine. This is a number for a recipe, and this is a number for a pair of ingredients, right? So this is a microscope, a quantifiable microscope at the molecular level, which allows me to look at the pairwise recipe, whether they are fit together in the recipes finally, are they used at all or not, and also whether a recipe itself is fit or not, depending on what is the flavor, number of flavor molecules, shared molecules do they have, and at the level of cuisine, right? So question is, what is the trend? Again, as I told you, that if the using the same 194 ingredients, 2543 recipes, if they were to be generated with the same size distribution, randomly, no pressure on either ways, no bias on either ways, what would be the number of molecules shared on an average? There would be something, right? Because every ingredient has got some molecules, and there are common molecules, by the way, right? Given that question, the answer to, in the case of this Western cuisines was that they are on the positive side. They tend to have ingredient pairs which are more and more similar to each other. Well, what we got in the case of Indian cuisine is that no, it's much lower and statistically significantly lower compared to that of a random cuisine. Indicating that, what does this tell us? This tells us that a typical Western cuisine ended up generating recipes which have ingredients which are similar to each other. You know, very, very similar to each other. Whereas in the Indian cuisine, we have got contrasting blend of ingredients of different types and flavor nature, right? So on an average, if I look at a recipe or a dish coming from Western versus Indian cuisine, a Western will be very, very similar. The number of diversity of molecules will be very small, molecules, flavor molecules, whereas the diversity of molecules in this Indian cuisine will be pretty large. Or different kind of molecules will be there, right? Okay, that's what it says. More the extent of flavor sharing between the two ingredients, lesser is the co-occurrence. By the way, when I say negative food pairing, there is nothing negative about negative. You see that? It's about more or less of extent of food pairing. That's what I'm talking about. So that's why these days I call it contrasting food pairing, because a lot of patriotic zealots, they got back to me saying that, why are you calling it negative? I said, okay, it's not negative, it's contrasting. Okay, so it's a contrasting food pairing. So, well, at the level of recipes, this seems to be so. Is it true at the level of pair of ingredients, at the level of across regional cuisines, etc.? We asked all kind of questions. The answer was same, right? So if you look at various regional cuisines across India, for which we had the data, we find that this is all in the negative zone. This is the whole Indian cuisine. And the one cuisine which seems to have negative food pairing, but on the lowest extent, is one Mughalai cuisine, which is an entrant, late entrant through the Mughals that have entered to India, right? So notice that also shows you some indicator that a cuisine which was not ethnically belonging to Indian subcontinent but has ended up coming here. And there are some cultural influences which have gone into this Mughalai cuisine also, right? So that's what we get. Not only that, we ended up creating the so-called like DNA fingerprinting, which tells you are you, you know. Similarly, whether by looking at the recipe and their molecular pattern, can we actually tell you that this recipe belongs to this regional cuisine kind of, right? The data is actually limited, but we could actually find out what is called as culinary fingerprints at the level of molecules. What is the contribution of a given category of ingredients, spices versus vegetable, etc.? We found that out, and we found that each cuisine, like this Bengali gen, etc., there is a pattern. You see that? It's like a synthesizer. If you change the levels, it will change the cuisine pattern, right? Okay. The next question that we asked for the whole Indian cuisine was this. I'm just trying to put things together so as to make it more coherent. Out of all 15 categories of non-veg, vegetables, spices, dairy, etc., fruits, which is the category, which is the most important category for the contrasting food pairing that we are seeing in the Indian cuisine? What did we do? Across all 2545 recipes, we said, okay, is vegetable important? Vegetable as in leafy vegetables, etc., all categorized into a bundle, around 40 of them. We said, okay, let's go through all the recipes, keep everything constant, except when there is a vegetable, from the basket of vegetable, randomly pick some other vegetable and keep it there. Okay? So you're basically randomizing one category across the whole cuisine. When you do that, if the food pairing remains the same, for example, I'd say that vegetables are not making any difference. Randomizing them doesn't make any change in the food pairing. So they're not important, right? I'll do this experiment for all categories. And what I found is that, this is Indian cuisine, and this is the kind of difference that is made by vegetable, fruits, plants, nuts, dairy, plant, etc., right? These are the kind of difference that is making, except for one category, and that was spice. you go through the recipes and you have a lot of things there, including few spices, let's say cumin, turmeric. I said, okay, randomize them. The moment you start randomizing spices, the whole food pairing phenomena that we have seen, which is different in Indian cuisine, is gone, right? So indicating that this is the statistical significance from the blue line to the spice line, telling us that consistently it shows us that spice is a fulcrum, may I say molecular fulcrum, flavor fulcrum of the Indian recipes. You will say, big deal, we know about it. Well, chefs knew about it. I talked to chefs, I participated in, you know, the great Indian cuisine and all that, conferences. We knew about it. But, you know, Dr. Bagler, thank you for telling us, you know, at a quantitative level. That's what we have done, actually. Right? So this is to say that spices are important. We actually quantified which spice is more important based on how much contrast it adds to the cuisine. And we found that spices, you know, they are the one, and of course quantification is available. And on the basis of that, these are the ingredients. Red chili is the king of it. That's the one, one which is actually a major contributory to the recipes that we have with us, right? And well, there are other spice category ingredients which are there. Okay, so essentially we are concluding that after doing this study, data analytics study, you see that of the Indian recipes, ingredients, molecules, we are talking about culture, we are talking about history, we are talking about chemistry, we are talking about physical phenomena which might have responsible for this, and we are telling us that, hello, spice is the taste of India. Okay. Okay, so this study was lauded a lot across various newspapers, starting with MIT Technology Review, then into Washington Post and all over, as I was telling you. And apart from being highlighted, identified as emerging technology, at the end of the year, it was identified as the best of 2015 on MIT Tech Review. So what, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, correct. Are there other features that we should be looking into, such as textures and feel, etc.? You're right about it. So as I said, we have taken two major factors, the smell and the taste, which are the most important and for which there is a molecular basis. For rest of them, yes, we should do that. Not only that, there are a lot of interesting things to be done. We are looking at only recipes and ingredients. What about the process? Boiling, frying, that would change the molecular nature, right? We should look at that also, right? So there are lots of interesting things to be done on this. But food being food, it takes a lot of effort to actually do such experiments and get the data for it. Data is not easily available. For only potato, for example, we could find raw potato versus baked potato molecular feature is available. But for no other ingredient, we could find such boiled versus raw inference available to us. So yes, all these features need to be included. This model has to be increased, etc. But it has not been done so. It's a very, very simplistic study and a simple conclusion. By the way, all these newspapers will tell you that scientists have figured out why Indian food is tasty. No, we have figured out only what is the phenomena at the molecular level, molecular pairing level, which makes Indian cuisine to have negative food pairing. Whether that is leading to taste or not, we don't know yet. We don't have an answer to that question, but press being press, it ended up tossing it in a different manner. Okay, what we are trying to do now is that, just to finish the talk, only last few minutes, I would say a couple of minutes, to tell you that this can, I mean, starting from where I started, I mean, I work on brain research also and disease and proteins and all that. I ended up coming and finding some lucrative area where companies started approaching me saying that we want to do this with you, product development, etc. Right? And we are creating an Android app now. Data is available with us. Pattern is known to us. Can we generate recipes, new recipes, which are traditional-like? Okay, follows the culinary fingerprint. Can we do that? And interestingly, the space of culinary recipes is huge. Given typical size of seven ingredients in a recipe, the total size, total number of recipes that you can generate is huge. Many of them would be not acceptable to us, by the way, but some of them would be. So we are spanning this space and creating new recipes. One day I started with a dream of becoming an astronomer. I worked in as a project student in Inter-University Center of Astronomy and Astrophysics when I was doing MSc Physics. And that was the time I worked in Ayuka, and I saw this quote very humbly put by these astronomers in their canteen, that the discovery of a new dish confers more happiness on humanity than the discovery of a new star. Well, in a retrospect, I am using this as an excuse that I actually wanted to discover something interesting, not necessarily star, but well, I've reached a stage where I'm ended up in a place where I can actually discover new recipes and hopefully make humanity more happy. Well, it has got a lot of implications in terms of novel recipe generation, food formulation, food beverage pairing, on which I have a consultancy project with a company now, hypothesis based generation of testing, because how does food affect our health and disease, nutrigenomics, how the nutrition affects our genome and how does it interact with it, and food disease association. All of these various interesting topics we are dealing now. So hopefully in this which was a little elongated session, I didn't expect it to go so long, I have been able to give you a gist of what's happening broadly in the area of computational biology, what are the problems and challenges lying in different domains of area, and interesting paradigm change that from a reductionist approach to a systems biology approach. I hope I have been able to convey this to you. And I must thank a group of youngsters who are working with me. I am smart because they are smart, and they are contributing to my work. So thank you, and I'll be able to take any questions. These are the broad opportunities and challenges. I keep it open so that you can have a look at it. Thank you. Thanks a lot.